play. So today I will talk about how we could collect payments with Triton and Stripe. So it will be a little bit similar to the talk of Coop&Go with for Paybox, because it's based a little bit on the same kind of API and so on. So let's start. What is Stripe? Stripe is an online payment platform. It started, I think, in 2010, I think, something like that. And it's a nice platform because it's very kind for developers. They provide a very nice API and so on. And they have a lot of features. So they, of course, take credit cards payments, but also they support ACH debits. I think it's some kind of debits from for America or the United States. They support Alipay, Bitcoins for the guys who like crypto money. They can do also SEPA direct debit. You don't have directly the option because it requires you to use the Stripe API and have some credit cards payments before activate the SEPA, because with SEPA you can take money from any bank account in Europe without any permission. So they want to be sure that you are a good business and you are not stealing people. And they support also Sofort. Sofort is a bank account payment, mainly used, I think, in Germany. And they have also other kind of payments, and they add regularly new way of collecting payments. They are paid by taking a fees on each transaction, and you have a minimal fees of 25 cents per transaction plus a percentage of the amount. So yeah, it costs you a little bit, but they do a lot of work for that. And you can track the fees on their website. So as I said, Stripe is really made for developers. They have a very simple API that you can query with just curl, and you make HTTP request, and you can do everything like that. They have a versioned API, so when they add new features, indeed, you on the URL of the API, you have the versioning. And so you can choose which version you want to keep, to run, and it doesn't change, and you choose when you start to use the new version. And so that's nice for the long term, and it doesn't push you to update when they change something in their application. They provide a lot of libraries to talk with them. So the HTTP API is nice, but it's even nicer when you can use it with your preferred language. And of course, they have libraries for Python and for JavaScript. And you can do all the operations with those libraries, and they manage everything for you. And they have a good documentation, very deep and with a lot of examples and so on. It's pretty easy to understand and to follow the documentation. And also, they have a very good support on the Stripe channel on Freenode. You can ask questions and you will have answer from someone of Stripe in the 5 minutes. Most of the time, they are very good at it and provide very good support and So now we are going to look at the payment workflow they've implemented. The first things you have to do is to create the source object with the information of the from your from the payment source. This means it could be a credit card or a Bitcoin address. If you this usually is run on the on the browser, and it's written in JavaScript. And this means that you never have to manage the sensible data from your customer, because it's the browser of the customer who process the credit card and talk directly with Stripe. And so you never see any credit card number in your backend, and so you don't have to comply with any security measure because you are touching credit cards. To have the API working, you just have to put your the API key, which is provided when you log in Stripe. They provide you with an API, a public API key that you can embed and put in your website. Everybody can read it. It's not a problem. And when you create a source, Stripe will return you a source ID that you can use later to make operation. And this ID is linked to your API key. So only you can use the source created to make to collect payments and so on. So even the source ID you get from Stripe is not a sensible data. You can share if you want with others, but don't do it. I don't think it's something you should try to do it. But this means that you can store it in your database. There is no risk of security. So what you have to do when you do the payment workflow is on the website, you create the token, the source, and you get the ID back to your to the Triton process. And then at the Triton backend, what you can do is create a customer. So this will register the payment methods from the real customer who entered it on the website. It stores it permanently on the Stripe the backend, and you can reuse the customer token to make further payment later if you want. Or so you just have to give the source you receive from your website and create a customer. This is an optional process. You can use the first source token to create a charge, or you can use the customer, the new customer token to create the charge. Once you have one token, a customer or a source token, no matter, you can have both. What you do on the backend is to create, to request the money you want. You want to take from the source, and so you just create a charge object like this. You just give the amount, the currency, and the token you get. So the token is the customer or the source, and that's all. Stripe will return you with if the payment succeed or not, and this you do it on the backend. So you don't have to, you don't need to have a webhook, a callback, because Stripe gives you directly if the credit card can pay the money or not. The thing that is a little bit particular is that here the amount is always expressed in the smaller unit of the currency. So here for euro, it's in cent. So this is a payment for 20 euro and not 2,000. They don't explain exactly why they do that in the documentation, but I guess it's to be sure to not have float issue, and so they have always amount in integer, and so they remove the float precision issue. And so, as I said, when you charge with a credit card, you get directly the information if the charge succeed or not. But you can have also webhooks with callbacks that tells you if the charge succeed or failed. This is useful because, as I said, when you charge with a credit card, you get directly the confirmation if it succeed or not. But there are some methods where you don't have the information directly. For example, for the SEPA, if you charge with a source which is linked to a SEPA account, it takes about 7 days, I think, before knowing that the charge succeed or not. In this case, you need to have the webhook to know when the payment is succeed or not. So, how does it work in Triton, this workflow? On the payment object, we added some fields. The charge ID, which is the charge we create with the token. And so we store also the token on the payment object. And so it's the we store the token, or we can store the customer. Both works. The Triton code will use the token if there is a token, or the customer if there is a customer. So we have an object in Triton that stores the customer for reuse later. You can reuse further. And the customer are, as we need to create them to the Stripe backend, we need a kind of synchronization between the Triton database and the Stripe database. And for that, as Triton API is based on working with a list of records almost everywhere, and Stripe doesn't provide us a transactional API, when we create the customer at the Stripe backend, we need to be sure that the customer is stored also in Triton. So we have a con task that process the creation of the customer one by one and commit after each call to the Stripe backend. Like that, we ensure that if something is wrong, we just lose the last customer tentative to create it, and we stay in synchronized with what we have in Stripe and what we have in the Triton database. And we have another task which delete the customer. So if you delete the customer in Triton, indeed it inactivates the record. And the current task will process it and try to delete at the Stripe backend before deleting in the database. And the same problem exists for the charge of the payments. So when you encode the payments and you ask to charge, it's not charged directly. There is a cron task that will process payment by payment to make the charge for the same reason than the customer. Like yesterday, I told it, we support the two-step charge workflow with first authentication and after that the capture of the charge. So for that, we have a button on the payment to say, I want to capture it. So by default, if you check that you don't want to capture the payment directly, it will just reserve the amount. And when you want really to capture it, you click on the button and it's captured. And finally, we have a wizard to make checkout. So it's open for you the web page to enter the credit card information and create just the part that should be run on the website. You can run it from the Triton client, but it's mainly for testing purpose, because you should not encode yourself the credit card of your customer. So we've seen that Stripe could have callbacks to us with webhooks. For that, we have created a route in the Triton, and we generate for each journal, payment journal, a shared key with Stripe, and this shared key is part of the route. So we can ensure that only Stripe can use the webhook, because you need to know the shared key. It's a long key. I don't remember the size. I think it's 64 char, something like that. But also Stripe, the data that Stripe sends us on the webhook is signed by Stripe, and the library, the Python library that they provide, have a method to validate the signature of the Stripe. So we validate it, so we are sure that it's really Stripe, that it's talking to us. And as it's a route in Triton, we have a protection against the size of the data, of the payload. It's a new feature that was added, I think, in 4.4. The requests made on Triton server now are limited on the size, so you cannot overload the server by sending gigabytes of data to Triton. And the webhook, at the end, each event is plugged to a webhook method with webhook underscore the name of the event. So you will have, for the charge, a method charge succeed, charge capture it, charge fail, charge pending. So it's each time webhook charge succeed. And the data you have, it's the payload of the callback of the Stripe, which for the charge, it's the charge object in a dictionary. And then you can process whatever you want, see if the amount is what you expected. If it's a failure, you have the reason and the error message for the failure, and so on. We have also webhook for the source creation. You have an event when the source is chargeable. This happens on some kind of payment methods, where the Stripe need to make some verification before telling you that you can use the source. So chargeable. I don't remember which source need to be chargeable. Maybe it's SEPA, that you create the SEPA and the source become chargeable a little bit later. And of course, and we support also the dispute. So when you have credit cards, payments, it may succeed, but the customer later, when he see the bank statement, he can say, no, I don't agree with this payment, and he can dispute it. Then you receive a notification by Stripe, and we put, with those two webhooks, we put the payment in failed, and then you can plead your cause with Stripe and say, no, it was a real payment, and the customer is wrong. Here is the bill and the services I provided, and so. And at the end, I think it's a conversation between Stripe and the bank, and they will decide if it was a real dispute or not. And so you can just win or fail the dispute. And if once the decision has been done, you have the dispute closed, event that is sent, and in it you know if you win or not the dispute, and then we put back the payment status. So now I will make a small demo of what we have in Triton, how it works. So here is my Triton, and I'm going to make a payment. Let's see. I have here some lines that I need to receive. Let's say I will take this customer. We are here in the standard process. So I will say I want to pay the lines. I need to select a journal, and I will. Wrong database.
Do you need my account number?
I need the trunk version to show the last feature. So if I still have something to pay to receive. Yeah, Stripe, it only works on receivable payment, because it only takes money from the customer. You cannot send money with the Stripe payment. So I will pay this invoice using the Stripe journal. And on the Stripe journal, you can see it's a Stripe with a process method Stripe. And we have, when you select the process method Stripe, you have here the Stripe account that appears. And indeed, it's the data for your Stripe account. So you can have multiple Stripe accounts and link to different journals and manage the way you want. Here are the keys that you get from the Stripe API interface. I can show you later if you want the Stripe dashboard. It's the test, so they have a test prefix, so you know that you can see the key, it's not a problem. But the secret key, you should normally not share with others. And here we can generate the URL for the webhooks. So, something is wrong there, so I will not generate. I will fix it later after the talk. But normally you can generate the entry, the endpoint, and you get the URL to put in the interface of Stripe. So, we'll make the payment. So now I have to, it's the usual workflow of Triton, only that here I need to define to give the Stripe customer, which I will take money, or the Stripe token if I have one. That usually it's filled from the website that puts the data, the token he created here. So here I'll pick one customer I've already created. And once I select the customer, normally here I could see the source that are linked, and I have no source. So instead, I will register this customer, Albright, as a, this party as a customer. Here I have the Stripe customer, and here I need it already exists. Okay, so that's not a problem. I will just pay with the customer, and without select, if I don't select a source, Stripe will take a default source for the customer. Just approve the payment, and now I will process it. So the payment, it's in the group. It is processing, but nothing happened. I need to run the cron that creates the charge. So I will manually start it. So here are all the cron, the Stripe cron. So there is one for to charge the payment, and I will request to run it now. I refresh the payment, and it does nothing.
You're not gonna be rich?
No. What is happening? What I think I will have. No, okay. Okay, maybe. Take a little bit more time. And now I have this ID, the charge ID that has been created on the by the Stripe server. And I receive a succeed because the customer have a credit card and have the money. I can show you on the dashboard. This is the Stripe website. And okay. Okay, this is the dashboard, and I can here see all the payments, and I should see what was the amount. This is the amount, it was in dollars, and so I have here the payments. I can select it and see that the event that happens. So Stripe make a risk evaluation, he said it was normal, so it accept to take the risk and make the payment succeed. You see here the details. You have all the information that happens on for this payment. You can see that there was a post to charge it, and so on. Maybe, and from the website here I can make a refund. But yeah, that's maybe I should. Yeah, what? No question? No? Okay. That's the for the workflow. So for the demo, and now I will show you some code if you want to see. Maybe too big.
So this is the module for the payment side. We have all the fields I told it that we added. There are few. Didn't show all the didn't talk about all the function fields because they are just there to put some data and help the on the interface. here the charge method. So this is the method called by the cron, and so it selects all the payments that are in the state processing, that have a stripe method, stripe. They have no token, and they are chargeable.
And they should have no charge ID, because otherwise they've already been created. And then here we call from the Stripe library the create method with all the data that come from these small methods that generate, so just put the API key, the amount in cent, the currency if we want to capture now or later, the description, the customer, the source, and so on. Here something that is nice also with Stripe, they allow you to put an independency key. With this key, they will ensure that if you try to make multiple calls with the same key, they will refuse. They will accept only the first one and refuse all the other. So even in this, when we process this method, if for some reason the transaction is or there is an issue, and we try to charge again the same payment when it was already charged, as we use here always the same key for the payment, it will not create more than one charge for this payment. And of course, we process some exceptions. You can have some Stripe error that some rate limits errors here that we just warn and we will retry later. It could happen if you have a lot of payments to do very quickly, but Stripe managed to have to support a very high level of requests, so it should not happen. You have the same methods, but for the capture, so it's pretty much the same, but this it selects payments that on which you click, and of course that are to be captured. Sorry. And now we have the webhooks here on the account definition. So it's mainly we receive the type of webhooks and we dispatch it to each method, and we put the payload in as parameter. And so, for example, when we succeed, we retrieve the charge object that is in the payload. We get the ID here to find which payment it belongs. And after that, we mark it if it was captured or not, save it, and put the status depending on the status of the charge. So if the Stripe tells us it was succeed, so we put it as succeed. And the same for the failure, but we store the error message for the failure, and so on. That's the routes. Maybe we can see here. So it's the entry point for the webhook call. We have here what we name the account, which is the large key, secret key that is generated. And we just verify here that the Stripe signature is valid by using this call. It's provided by the Stripe library, and after that it calls the webhook methods for the account. Yeah, that's pretty much all. No question? Yeah?
Why store the secret key? Okay.
Why store the secret key in the database and not in the config file?
Because first you can have as many as account as you want on site, so the user can define a new account and start to use it. So we find it more convenient for the user to be able to manage it himself. It's Stripe account that he registered to the Stripe and get the information there and fill it in the Triton database. Because otherwise, if it's in the configuration file, you need to ask to the developer or to the operator who set up Triton to put the value in the right configuration file and before being able to activate the functionality. So for me, it makes more sense to let people be able to manage this themselves from the interface. Also, there is an access right on the account object. Here, so nobody can read the account object except those that are in the accounting admin group. So only the administrator can see the information. And those that are in the group payment, but only the admin, the account admin, can see the secret key, can read the secret key. Everybody else cannot read it. So we limit the number of people that can get the secret key. And so this way, it's at some point, we are quite safe. I guess the question was about security, maybe. I don't think configuration file or database is really different for the security. It's in clear text somewhere in your hard drive. So maybe we could implement a kind of vault that we can retrieve the data when we need, but I don't know if it's really needed.